Welcome. Let's begin with one of the very interesting topics, and that's the Indian Constitution. We'll be starting with our class 11 NCERT, focusing on why there was a need for the Constitution to be formed, what was the major steps that were taken under Indian Constitution and its formulation. So let's first talk about the need. As we know, in any country, or any country if we talk across the globe, we have people from different religion, different age group, different profession, different ethnicity. So when you have such a huge diversity that is present, there should be some rule which brings people at a common stand. So bringing in coordination, a good assurance, is very, very important. And for that, you should have a basic book. And that basic rule book, we could say, is the Constitution. Now, Constitution helps people to agree on certain rules, which are very, very basic, very, very fundamental. And these try to protect the dignity of each and every individual of the country. So, what is there in the Constitution must be known to all the members and must be brought into effect for everyone in the society. Let's talk about very simple issues, talking about whether the property should be owned or who should be allowed to own the property, talking about children going to school, compulsory education, talking about safety, security. So all these issues fall under the Constitution of India. The very first function, we can say, of the Constitution is to provide a rule book or the basic rules which bring in coordination among the members of the society. So bringing in coordination among the members of the society is very, very important. I can have a very simple example for you. Let's say in your class, you have a class representative, the CR, who is elected. Now that CR looks after or performs his duties. He also takes decisions on your behalf and looks that if each and every person in the class or student in the class is given the due rights. So all of those things are being monitored, and that's how we understand the very first function, that is bringing in basic rules and coordination. The second important function is to specify the power. Who has the authority to make the power or the decisions, and the government, how does it function? So understanding who makes the decisions in the society is important. So bringing in the fundamental principles, deciding how the laws would work and abiding by those laws become important. So parliament decides to get in various laws and policies, and bringing in a kind of organized manner under which these could function. So functioning of the Constitution becomes another important aspect, and when we say functioning, definitely you have allocation of the powers. So these are some of the very, very important aspects that have been covered under the second function of the Constitution. As I said, the second function is to specify who has the power to make a decision and decide how the government would be constituted. The third important function is to set down the limits on what the government can impose to the citizen. So let's say if there is a racial discrimination, if there is a religious discrimination, if there is a discrimination based even on choosing a color that a person wants to. So all these things are unfair and unjust. These things affect the functioning of a proper governance, we could say. And therefore, the function of the Constitution is to set the limits on what government can impose onto the citizen. So government cannot impose something or debar the person from practicing certain religion. So we say Indian Constitution is secular. Similarly, any kind of unjust, unfair behavior cannot be propagated. The next is, under this aspect only, we focus on fundamental rights, the very basic right that an individual has. So it is freedom to speech, freedom to have, to practice your own religion, freedom to form associations, freedom to conduct a trade or a business. So all these practices are allowed to be practiced across the country only in cases of national emergency or certain circumstances when the constitution specifies it, these rights are withdrawn. Otherwise, everyone, all the citizens of the country have these fundamental rights. So that's the third important function. The fourth important function of the constitution is to fulfill the aspirations of the society and create a kind of just society for everyone. Now, when I say bringing in aspirations and goals, what does we mean? We mean that till 19th century, government was trying to allocate the decision-making powers. However, later 20th century witnessed the reforms where you had Indian constitution as a unique example, which was highly innovative, and this was a framework meant for bringing in positive things, expressing the aspirations and the goals of the people, enabling, empowering the government to make decisions. So in India, we say there has been no racial discrimination. South Africa ended the caste discrimination in the new constitution that was given. It also talked about conservation of nature, protection of the person against the discrimination, and housing for all. Similarly, Indonesian constitution, if we say, focused on a national education system. Poor and destitute child would be taken care of. So each of the constitutions across the globe have their unique ideas. When we say Indian constitution is really a unique constitution because we have taken elements from various constitutions across the globe. Also, when we talk about Indian constitution, we focus on the positive welfare measures which are legally enforceable. So those are some of the important aspects that we cover under Indian constitution. We talk about directive principles of state policies, the DPSPs. We talk about the preamble of the constitution. So those are some of the aspirations and the goals that we aim to achieve. So we say socialist, secular, democratic republic. So those are some of the aspirations that we aim to achieve. Again, when we focus on the constitution, we try to maintain two things. One is the political identity, the second is the moral identity. Now, constitution norms are set in such a way or bring in a framework that brings in or pursues individual aspiration, goals and freedom. So constitution helps us to provide a kind of moral identity. People agree to the basic set of norms that are there, and most of the political and moral values are shared across the constitutional traditions. Now, if we talk about the writings of Iraq's constitution, which came after the collapse of Saddam Hussein, it saw a lot of conflict between the various ethnic groups during that time. Most of the nations, we see there is a kind of merger of or amalgamation of complex historic traditions that are there. Similarly, in Germany, being German ethnically maintains your citizenship, but the same is not the case in India. So ethnic identity is not a criteria for citizenship in India. So each of the constitutions have their own way under which the things are being laid down. Now, what do we mean by a constitution? So constitution, simply we can say it's a compact document with article, norms and criteria that are being laid down. Again, in UK, very interesting, there is not just one document, there is a series of documents that is there. And most of the successful constitutions across the globe, three of those we say are India, South Africa and United States. All of these came after some popular national movements that happened in the country. In South Africa, it was against the racial discrimination. Again, in India, it was after the independence that came in. So, Indian constitution started during the period of December 1946. Now, very, very important to note, it was 1946 when it started. After that, we had the independence that occurred. And finally, it came into force, or it was drawn in November 1949, came into force on January 26, 1950. So, executed then. So, the thing is here that there is a kind of independence movement that affected the formulation of the constitution. it brought in public credibility. The ideas that were being flowing in the people, and the makers of the Indian constitutions were unique in themselves because all of them had differences in the opinion. Now, since there were so many differences in the opinion, each person in the constituent assembly was trying to bring out his or her views. Even after that, there was a point where a negotiation took place. So that's why we say respect for the society, national consciousness, talking about negotiation, public credibility becomes very important when we are ultimately formulating a constitution. Definitely, it is a challenge in itself. Now, Indian constitution has never been a subject to referendum. However, you have public authority and consciousness, the popular leaders who always back the ideas of the constitution of India. So, no constitution by itself achieves perfect justice. Therefore, we say it is the idea to convince the people that it provides a framework for basic justice. Again, what happens if you have something which is too rigid? If you try to bend it, it will break. Again, if something is too flexible, what would happen? There won't be enough security. Same goes with the constitution. So constitution should neither be too rigid or too flexible, as we have the Indian constitution, neither too rigid nor too flexible. And it's only then you have the scope to bring in changes, you have to have the scope to bring in amendments. And therefore, we say Indian constitution is a living document. It's a living document because you have amendments that keep on going. So every time you feel there is a need to change the existing norms or existing rules that are there, you bring in an amendment. And therefore, Indian constitution is considered to be a living document, very, very important. Now again, when we talk about constitution, you have the mode of promulgation that is very important, how the provisions are being maintained into the constitution, and a very balanced institutional design. So when I say balanced institutional design, that means you have well-crafted constitution which is being given by intellectual people who have been working with the common people very closely, understanding the needs of the common people. The idea is no single institution should acquire a monopoly. And when we say that, we bring in all the three pillars, that is the legislative, executive and judiciary on the par. And these three pillars, along with the independent bodies like election commission, bring in a kind of system which balances or brings in a good success for the Indian constitution. So bringing in right balance is very, very important. And therefore we say a constitution should be a balanced institutional structure. Similarly, the ability of the constitution to command allegiance of the people is dependent on the fact that the constitution is just. So only when people have faith that the constitution is just, there would be allegiance from the people that would be there. Now we come on to the most interesting thing, the making of the Indian constitution. The making of the Indian constitution, as I said, it started in December 1946. Now all this was laid down under the Cabinet Mission Plan 1935. The Cabinet Mission Plan 1935 had provincial legislative assemblies, and this had certain ideas in mind. The first idea was the seats would be divided under three categories: Muslim, Sikhs and general category, with proportion to the population that was there. The members of each of the community in the provincial legislative assembly would elect their own representatives by proportional representation through single transferable vote. Also, the method of selection for princely states was to be determined by consultation, and each of the province of the princely state or the group of the states was allocated to the proportion of the population of the state. So it was roughly 1:10 lakh. So that was the ratio that was demarcated. Initially, the provinces that were elected had 292 members, and the princely states had 93 members. So those were the members that were initially there. However, during this time, the partition took place. As we said, it started in 1946. And after that, in 1947, you had the partition of the country. It was a violent effort during that time, and only finally 284 members were left in the present-day India. And the remaining went off in the regions of Pakistan. So what happened was the number of members declined. Of these members, you had 26 members which were from the scheduled caste. Similarly, you had minorities, the issue of minorities that came in, bringing security to the minority. Religious identity should not have bearing onto the citizenship was some of the major drivers of the constitution during that time. As I said, issues, so these were the major issues. Now, the views of the people who were formulating the Indian constitution varied. For example, Ambedkar's view was very different from Gandhian and Congress views, because he considered that upliftment of scheduled caste is very important. Similarly, Patel and Nehru disagreed on many fronts. So there was a kind of constant clash in the ideologies of the people who were the part of the draft committee of the Constituent Assembly or the Constitution of India. Formation of the Constitution of India. So there were issues like whether we should have a centralized government or a decentralized government, how much power should be given to the judiciary, whether judiciary should be independent body or not, what should be the method of representation between center and the state, the powers, the relations between the center and the state, should we have universal adult suffrage that should be there, so those were kind of issues that were always part of the thinkers or the members of the draft committee. However, there were attempts to reach onto a conscience level where we could bring things at par, and over the period of nearly 166 days, or what we say 2 years and 11 months, this was finally resolved, and you had the constitution that finally came into being. It was open to lot of public and press issues. So bringing in a concrete shape for the constitution was very, very important. Upholding the values that are laid down in the constitution, bringing in the best summary of the principles that were part of the nationalist movement for independence, were brought through an objective resolution in India. Now, what was the major idea under the objective revolution? It believed India to be an independent, sovereign, secular nation. India should be a union of the various states that are there. Also, the territories of the union that are there should be autonomous. So bringing in a kind of federal structure was one of the ideas. Bringing in independence, securing the social economic justice of the people, checking the minorities, the backward and the tribal groups are getting adequate rights. Their rights are being safeguarded. So those were some of the key issues that were brought in. And also based on this objective resolution that was laid down, institutional expression and fundamental commitments came in. Those were in the form of bringing equality, liberty, democracy, sovereignty, and a kind of common identity among the people. So what we can broadly understand is this constitution is not a book for the rules and the procedures. Rather, it is a moral commitment to establish a government, to fulfill the promises that have been laid down or upholded during the nationalist movement that took place in India. So the institutional arrangement need to be understood in this line. And therefore, we understand that there are various things that are very, very important to understand. So, the first is bringing in a kind of federal arrangement, a parliamentary form of government, a testimony to the learning procedure, and the constitution should be framed in such a way that we are focusing always on removing the failures from the country and accommodating the needs of the country. So those are some of the institutional arrangements. Coming on to the ideas being taken from the various countries across the globe. So from France, we have the idea of liberty, equality and fraternity that we took. From United States, we took the idea of fundamental rights. We took the idea of independent judiciary and judicial review. From Britain, we took the idea of first past the post. We talked about parliamentary form of government, the rule of law and the lawmaking procedures. From Canada, we took a quasi-federal form of government and the concept of residual powers. From Ireland, we took the ideas of directive principles of state policies. So from across the globe, we had the scholars who were trying to bring in the best from the different constitutions of the world. And therefore, this constitution is very, very important to understand, a very important concept, a very interesting concept in your political science. So stay tuned for further updates. Have a wonderful day.